It has taken me about 2 years to write this sermon because I started chewing on it about 2 years ago and I was thinking about something about prayer, and then I got a phone call. You ever get a phone call? I had a phone call. It was the bishop asking me if I'd like to consider a move, to which the correct answer is, yes, sir. And so here I am, and I've been here about a year and a half now, so this is 2 years later. I was thinking and chewing on prayer, and it's been good to let it marinate for that long. I've been pondering this because not only do I fundamentally believe that to pray is part of following Jesus, but I also am not sure at times if I am doing a good job in helping people in the practice of prayer. While I was pondering this, I ran across some stories by a fellow named Dan Dick, who's a pastor up in Iowa, who now he has led churches into healthy, growing futures, and now he consults, and he'll show up and he helps churches realize something has to change, and so he'll come on in, and he's telling some stories about when he came in and he started talking to churches about prayer and how he's been confused by what he's starting to see. How he went to one church, he suggested to them that as a church board, you need to start with prayer. Whatever you're leading towards, are you praying for it? Are you praying for what you desire? And that's where he wanted to start, with helping this board turn to its future. And he got an email the next day on Monday telling him that he had really been a waste of their time and they didn't understand why he was talking about prayer. And he was confused by that. And then something like that happened again. Another church, he went and talked to the trustees and the PPR and the board. And he said, you know, why won't we spend a month praying for the future of the church? And he got another of those emails saying, you really blew your credibility. We were looking for practical ideas and you came talking about prayer. Well, I echo Dan's belief that prayer is indeed practical. It is the root of everything else, and I think that it can fade at times. We can lose track of that. But I do believe that if a church is not rooted in prayer, it's not rooted. Like, that's it. If a church is not praying, then if it's not rooted in prayer, it's not rooted at all. That it sustains the life of the church. As Paul describes it, is the life of the church is to pray without ceasing. And to be clear, when I talk about church, what I'm talking about, we have these things, and they're nice things. Some of them are heavy things, but like, we have a big old pulpit here and nice walls. I mean, this all is great stuff, but it's not church, right? This is not the church. The church is a set of relationships that you have together as we gather in the name of Jesus. That's church, right? You all come together as people who name Jesus as Lord. That set of relationships, that's church. This building just happens to be where we get together to church, right? So church is rooted in prayer. And the church is the gathering people who follow Jesus together. While musing about this, it was reinforced to me how important it is that we name that prayer is the beginning of everything. It's the root of everything. I was listening to a lady named Sue Kibbe, who is doing work with churches over in Ohio, and she said, you know what, I've worked with churches, and they've tried all the things that churches try to get going. They'll send their pastor off to education, and he or she will come back with a book of ideas, all these notes, and then they talk about it with the board, and you know what happens to that book of notes? Goes on the shelf and gets dusty, right? Y'all know how that happens, right? Or the leaders of the church get together to read a book together and then promptly just kind of move on. Sometimes churches can try to reorganize, to streamline decision making, or sometimes you invite in a consultant. Never forget that a consultant, an expert, is anyone who has to drive more than an hour to get here, right? That's what makes someone an expert. Did they have to drive? Ooh, they must be smart. But you can come up and bring an expert in and put together a one-year plan, a five-year plan, or you can rework a mission statement. You can hire more staff. If we want to go somewhere as a church, maybe we just need to hire a youth person. Many of these are good ideas, but they're not the beginning. The beginning of change in a church is prayer, because you can't change a church until you change the relationships with each other and the relationship with Jesus. Right? Everything else is just window dressing. Prayer is is the essential beginning. And we should be honest about ourselves with prayer. Prayer doesn't come naturally, right? I struggle with prayer. I will be the first to admit. It's something that I've had to work at for years to find a way that works for me. This is not a surprise. It's been known for a while. There's a guy named Oswald Chambers. This is what he writes about prayer. Prayer is not a normal part of the life of the natural man. Right? We hear it said that a person's life will suffer if he doesn't pray. But I question that. What will suffer is not the person's life, but the life of the Son of God in him, which is nourished not by food, but by prayer. When a person is born from above, the life of the Son of God is born in him, and he can either starve or nourish that life. Prayer is the way that the life of God in us is nourished. Right? Prayer is the way that the life of God in us is nourished. I don't pray for me, right? I pray so that Jesus will be in me. To pray is to invite God into our lives, into this moment, into our church, into our community. To invite God into our lives, and further, it's not something that's just done when we are at church. Most of us, most of the time when we pray here. And what's that look like? You bow your heads and Andy talks, right? And that's a start. That's a good thing. Like the past part of the pastor's calling is to gather the prayers of the people and to offer them. But that's just the start, right? The rest of the week, to pray without ceasing is to pray while we walk, pray while we drive, to pray while we eat, to pray for those around us on a regular basis. That's what Paul is writing in 1 Thessalonians, as he's writing of. When he writes to Thessalonians, the church at Thessalonica is one of the earliest churches, and this is one of the earliest letters. This is like baby steps for Christians. What does Paul think they need to know about prayer? Prayer without ceasing, right? Pray on a regular basis. Rejoice, pray without ceasing, examine everything carefully. Okay, pastor, that sounds nice, but what do I do? Brass tacks. Like, give me something to do. I hear you. I ask the same question, right? The continuing theme of this sermon is how much I've learned from others, and another thing I've learned from others about prayer. C.S. Lewis talks about prayer, and he talks about there's this temptation to prayer to, like, compose ourselves. You know, like, just be aware of God. And one of two things happens if I do that. Right? If I do that in the morning, I fall asleep. And if I do it in the afternoon, I start thinking about the grocery list. Right? Maybe you can focus and maybe that works for you, but I gotta tell you, I need some content, right? I need some practices. I need something to work with. And I think we see this in our lives because if we want to have a relationship with each other, if I want to have a relationship with my son, I can sit there and sort of bask in the four-year-oldedness of my son. Or I can play with blocks. Right? We build a tower. 2 days ago, I showed him how to Godzilla a tower of blocks. Just like throw yourself into it. He loved it, right? And now we're doing that together. We're throwing ourselves at towers of blocks. That is a relationship with a four-year-old, right? And it's the same thing with other people in our lives. I could just like compose myself and bask in the Olivianessness of my wife. Or I could unload the dishwasher. You know what one she wants? Right? Nothing says I love you like a clean kitchen. I mean, that's very serious, right? That it's true. And we talk about I can love the congregation. I can compose myself and sit in the office and like just appreciate how wonderful you are. Or I can write the sermon, right? You want me to write the sermon. Our relationships are mediated through content. There are things we do that build this relationship when we do them again and again and again, and it is the same thing with prayer. Prayer is the building block of our relationship with God, and I think that coming together around one common prayer, repeating it and learning together, is a good thing. So I have put together... I have crafted something. I put together some words. This is my gift to you. This is my offering. This is the prayer I offer to you for us to use for the following year. It is the first Sunday of the new year, right? Advent 1, here we go. And so if those who I gave a stash of these, if you want to pass those around. We put this together. I wrote it, and Deb made it pretty and formatted it and made it laminated and all that, so she gets the credit for that. But I put this together so that you can put this where you pray in the morning, or put it on your mirror where you brush your teeth, or put it in your dash so you see it when you get in the car, or put this in your wallet so that every time you open it, you will see it and you will think, this is a way to pray continuously, to pray without ceasing. I want to point out a few things about it. First, this prayer is written, it is written with plural pronouns. It's like when you pray the Lord's Prayer, what is the first two words of the Lord's Prayer? Our Father. You say that even if you pray alone, don't you? But you never pray alone. You always pray Our Father. This is written in the same way, so that we are always praying together as a church. We pray, the ordering matters, right? We begin by praying, enter into our lives, open the door. God, you do something. Because if we start doing it, it's about us, right? You enter into our lives, because prayer is how we invite you into our lives continuously. And then open doors, and finally, give us the courage to do something about it, right? Give us courage to step through those doors and towards your kingdom. Roger Ross, he's a leader at the conference office. He helped shape this prayer. He doesn't realize it. But he talked about an annual conference one year. He was praying for wisdom about where to go next, and he knew that it was time to go do something new. And he kept on praying for wisdom, and he was asking other people to pray with him for wisdom about what to do. And finally, one of his friends looked at him and said, Roger, when are you going to stop praying for wisdom and start praying for courage? Because I think you already know, and I think now you need to pray for courage to do it. Right? And so that's how this sort of wraps up. Lord, enter into our lives. Open doors that lead us into new seasons of faithfulness and fruitfulness, and give us courage to step through those doors and towards your kingdom. Now, these words are not magic. Like, there's no magic words. They're, just like there's no magic in what you do to love your people and your family. It's practical, right? But it is the beginning of our relationship with God. It's the way that we practice, it's the way we maintain our relationship, it's how we give thanks for whatever it is that does happen. It's the way that we pray such that God's life is in our lives. Now, as I've been telling, I want to wrap up by telling you the same thing I've been telling churches this entire fall. I've been going to charge conferences where clusters of 15 churches get together and we do the work of the business of our church. And so every church in the Mark Twain district, as of tonight, there was one more tonight, will have heard this same thing. And I will tell you, the Calvary is not coming. All right. Often our response to problems is to hope someone will show up and fix them. Like, hope that maybe youth will just flood into the church, or maybe Pastor Perfect will show up and everything will be just perfect. And I know pastors, I can tell you, Pastor Perfect is not going to show up. And he hasn't shown up, just in case you weren't at all clear on that. You are the Calvary, and here's why. You are the response to the problems of your lives and your communities and your church and all our situations, because in prayer we are welcoming Jesus into our lives, and that is the response. If you want to have your life be transformed, if you want our church to be transformed, if we want our community to be better, we don't wait for someone else to do something about it. We invite Jesus into our lives and partner with him so that something happens. Prayer is the beginning of changing our lives, our churches, and our communities for the better. And so I invite you to pray with me this prayer this year, which means that I'm going to end every worship service with this prayer. We're going to begin every meeting with this prayer. We're going to begin every book, every Bible study with this prayer. And if I forget, feel free to smack me. Andy, hey, you forgot, right? Carry this with me and throw it at me. It would actually be pretty funny. I invite you into this year of prayer with me so that we might invite Christ into our lives, that we would step towards his kingdom. Amen.